We're welding spacers straight onto the pile bars, right on the axis lines. That locks in the foundation layout before any mesh goes in. They show the exact contour of the wall, so we don't need strings after this. They also help us visualize the concrete cover. For basement walls, that's usually between 2.5 and 5 centimeters, enough to stop moisture from reaching the rebar and prevent corrosion long term. Plus, each spacer marks the full wall width, 25 centimeters, so we know exactly where our inner and outer rebar lines need to stay. This step sets the blueprint for the whole mesh. We're welding spacers onto every pile, not just for layout, but so every bar that comes after lands exactly where it should. No guesswork, no drift. Once they're all in, we're ready to move on to the next stage. We're welding in all four rows of horizontal bars for this wall, each one made from 12 millimeter steel. These bars are critical. They hold the wall together lengthwise and help control cracking from pressure, shrinkage, and settling. We're using 12 mil because it's strong enough to handle basement loads, but still practical to work with. Cuttable, bendable, and welds clean. The spacing between rows isn't random either. It's measured to match the structural plan and to line up perfectly with the verticals. Every weld here locks in the shape and strength of this wall before the concrete even touches it. To keep the gaps between these horizontal bars consistent, we're using a wooden spacer that's been cut to exactly 30 centimeters. That way, we don't need to measure every single gap. Just place the spacer and weld. It saves time, keeps everything aligned, and guarantees the mesh stays tight and even across the wall. 30 centimeters is a standard spacing for double mesh in basement walls. Strong enough for pressure, but open enough to tie verticals clean. Now we're finishing the rest of the horizontal bars on all sides of the basement. The end wall is only 4 meters long, so one full-length bar does the job. No joints needed. But the side wall is 8 meters, so we join rebars to reach the full span. We lay one full-length piece, then cut a second, and connect them using a third bar that overlaps both ends by at least 50 centimeters. That overlap helps transfer tension smoothly across the joint. It acts like a structural bridge, and we stagger all the joints so they don't line up vertically. That avoids any weak points forming in the wall. We're spacing the horizontal bars every 30 centimeters, which keeps the mesh strong and gives us clean tie points for verticals later. Tighter spacing also helps distribute pressure more evenly when the wall starts working, especially in high load areas like corners. This whole setup is a double mesh system. One layer near the outside, one near the inside of the wall. That gives the wall strength from both directions and helps it resist bowing, soil pressure, and long-term stress from temperature or movement. If you skip the second mesh, the wall's more likely to crack or flex in the middle, especially in basements like this, where pressure builds over time. Double mesh takes longer, but it's what separates temporary builds from real structural work. To keep the mesh plumb and lock our corners in place, we're using 90-degree bent bars with a 50-centimeter overlap on each side. We transfer the level using a spirit level, starting from the bottom horizontal bar we know is correct. Once aligned, we tag weld the corner bar to both walls. This bar doesn't just hold position, it reinforces the junction and helps transfer loads between walls. It's a key part of making the mesh act as one solid structure. To keep the mesh locked in place and fully plumb, we're adding diagonal braces across the wall. We're using the same 12 mm bars and welding each one directly to the pile bars. These diagonals act like temporary supports, but they stay in place and help the mesh hold its shape during the pour. They stop any shifting, twisting, or leaning, especially across longer spans where things tend to move. Without these diagonals, even small vibrations or pressure from tying can throw the whole mesh out of line. Once they're in, the wall frame becomes much more rigid and ready for the next stage. We're marking 30-centimeter gaps along the bottom horizontal bars. That's where each vertical rebar will go. To do it, we're using a correction pen. It leaves a bright white line that stands out on steel, even when the bars are dusty or we're working in low light. Unlike chalk or pencil, it won't rub off while tying, and having all the marks set in advance makes it way faster to keep spacing even while installing the verticals. Each vertical bar starts like this, carried in by hand, lined up, and locked into the frame. We place it directly onto the 30-centimeter mark we made earlier. No guessing, no measuring twice. Those marks save time and make sure every vertical lands exactly where it should. Once the bottom touches that mark, we weld it in to fix the base. That first weld isn't just to hold it, it anchors the bar to the structure so the load transfers clean into the piles. Then we grab the spirit level, stand the bar plumb, and tag weld the top to hold it in place. Vertical bars are the backbone of the wall. They take on compression from the weight above and help resist cracking from shifting or settlement. This method keeps every vertical straight, evenly spaced, and tied solid to the frame. One at a time, they don't look like much, but together they make the wall work. These bars are 3 meters long, even though the concrete wall in this first pour will only go up to 2.2. That extra height isn't a mistake, it's deliberate. Once the wall is done, we'll bend that exposed steel over and tie it into the rebar mesh for the top concrete slab. That way, the slab and wall become one solid structure, not two pieces stacked on top of each other. You'd be surprised how often people skip this. They stop the rebar at the top of the wall, and later their slab cracks or separates because nothing ties the layers together. We're thinking ahead now so the structure stays locked long term. Same goes for the horizontal bars. We're only placing them halfway up for now because this first pour is only the bottom half of the wall. The verticals need to go full height immediately so we can bond both pours together without any cold joint failure. If you've ever poured a wall in two parts, how did you lock the sections together? Drop it in the comments, or let me know what you would have done differently. Now we're on the outside, welding the vertical rebars that'll run to the exact height of the wall, 2.2 meters. These won't extend past the top like the inside bars because the slab reinforcement will be tied into the inner mesh. Each vertical gets tag welded to the top and bottom horizontal bars, just enough to keep it locked in place for now. We're not fully welding these bars because overwelding can cause stress points or weak spots in the steel. Once everything's in position, we go back and tie the entire mesh together with steel wire. That wire ties everything tight and lets the wall flex just enough to handle pressure, movement, and temperature shifts over time. Every vertical is matched with the inside mesh, so once the pour happens, the two layers work together. It's all about solid connections, locking the wall into one strong unit that holds for the long haul. This part of the mesh is fully done and ready for concrete. It's all tied, aligned, and locked in. We'll finish the rest of the mesh after this section is poured and cured. Now we're moving on to the second part of the mesh, building it up above the first pour. Luckily, all the vertical bars were already welded in earlier, so we don't need to deal with that again. We're just adding the horizontal rebars now, using the same 30 cm spacing stick we used before. Each bar gets tacked in place, just enough to hold it steady for now. It's the same process as before, just higher up the wall. This next layer will tie straight into the lower mesh once everything's locked together, making it one solid structure from top to bottom. The only bar we're leaving out is the very top one, because that one won't sit level. It'll be welded in later at an angle to match the slope of the future concrete slab. For the top rebar, we marked the lowest and highest points on the wall, then ran a string line through all the verticals. That gave us a clean slope to follow, and we marked each bar with a correction pen so the rebar sits exactly where it should. Now we're installing the top rebar, lining it up carefully with all the marks we made earlier. Since this bar runs at an angle, it needs to be even more precise than the rest. We're tag welding it to every vertical bar to keep the slope clean and consistent from one end to the other. This one's the final rebar for the wall, and it sets the edge for the slab connection that's coming next. We're making sure it stays fully embedded in concrete with a 4 to 5 cm cover all the way through. That spacing isn't just for looks. It protects the steel from moisture and corrosion and helps the wall hold up long term. With the top rebar in place, we've only got one part left, the front section by the entrance. We're leaving a gap for the door here, with about 4 cm of space from the edge to give the concrete enough coverage. Just like the rest of the wall, we're building it up row by row. Only difference is these rebars are shorter, so they're quicker to handle and easier to line up. And since this section will have an opening, we're adding a few extra horizontal bars above the door to help spread the load and prevent cracking over time. Those bars act like a small lintel built right into the mesh. They take pressure off the opening and keep that section stronger. Doorways are one of the first places concrete wants to crack, especially with movement or settling, so giving it extra reinforcement now helps avoid future problems. Once this front bit is done, that's the last of the mesh, ready for tying and prep before the pour. Before we start tying everything together with steel wire, there's one more thing to take care of. We go around and cut off any rebar ends sticking out past the wall line. If we leave them, they'll get in the way when we start leveling concrete or setting up formwork. They also mess with the surface line and can cause gaps where the slab should sit tight. Cutting them now keeps everything clean, accurate, and easier to finish. It also helps the form board sit flush, so we're not fighting tight spots during bracing. And any exposed steel past the concrete edge becomes a weak point. It can rust, swell, and start breaking the surface. So we cut it clean now to avoid problems later. Now we're tying everything up with steel wire, locking the mesh tight before the pour. We're doing it all by hand, not with a tying gun. This way, each connection gets pulled tighter, and we can feel if something shifts or doesn't sit right. We're using a simple homemade hook with a handle, nothing fancy, but it works fast and gives you control. Hand tying takes longer, but it gives a stronger bond and you can adjust as you go. It also avoids loose ties that sometimes happen with machines, especially on uneven mesh or tricky corners. And tying isn't just to hold the bars before the pour, it keeps them locked together inside the concrete even after it cures. That way the steel stays where it's supposed to be, and the structure holds its strength over time, not just on day one. The mesh is done. Formwork's coming next. If this video helped, hit like. Got thoughts or ideas? Drop a comment. And if you're into real builds like this, make sure to subscribe. More's on the way.